With a lot of talk about COVID vaccines in the news at the moment, here at the MS Trust, we're starting to get a lot of questions popping up from people with MS and how the vaccine would, what it would mean for people with MS. So we thought we would try to find some answers if possible. So today we are talking to Professor Alistair Coles, who is a neurologist at Addenbrookes. Hi. Could you talk us through how a COVID-19 vaccine would work? We gather there's lots of different companies that are working on vaccines, and they might work differently.
Well, it's a pleasure to talk about this because there is a lot of confusion. And although I'm not a vaccine expert, we can talk a little bit about how a vaccine might affect people with MS. So this week we've had the fantastic news of the first positive result from one of the vaccine trials. And that's good news for everyone, clearly. It's particularly good news because this vaccine was targeted against one of the parts of the COVID virus, the S protein, that nearly every other vaccine is targeted against. So even if this particular vaccine doesn't end up working for one reason or another, it's shown that this is a good strategy that all the other vaccines more or less are adopting. So we can be more confident now than we ever have been that a useful vaccine will come along shortly. And there'll be two clear effects of this for people with MS. One is that the more people who take this vaccine will reduce the number of people who can be infected by COVID, and will therefore reduce the overall infection rate, and therefore will reduce the chance of someone with MS being exposed to someone who has COVID. And secondly, of course, people with MS will get the vaccine at one point or another, and if it's effective in them, which is a key point which we'll come back to, then they will have direct immunity against COVID. So there are two broad effects that a COVID vaccine will have.
And what time scales are we looking at? How close are they sort of ready to be used? Because normally when you hear about people producing any kind of medication or vaccines, it takes quite a long time. So how were they actually able to do this so fast?
Yeah, so one of the really exciting things about this awful COVID pandemic has been the determination to shorten the development time for drugs. So the normal development time for a vaccine is nearly 10 years, and it's been shortened to between 1 and 2 years through a really concerted effort between funders and regulators and so on. So we anticipate, those of us in the NHS will have been hearing rumours and getting emails that healthcare workers may be vaccinated with one vaccine or another in the NHS in the UK this December. So I imagine that we healthcare workers are the first group to be vaccinated, but will shortly be followed thereafter by people who are especially vulnerable. And so that would be the elderly, those with diabetes, hypertension, combined comorbidities, and also people with MS on immunosuppressant drugs. So I imagine that people with MS, particularly on immunosuppressant drugs, or those with significant disability, will be in the second wave. And when will that be? Well, I'm guessing now, you know, before Easter of next year, somewhere around there.
So that's quite positive still. I mean, quite fast turnaround.
I mean, this is unprecedented, the speed that we've gone from first discovering about this new virus to having not one, but many potential vaccines available.
So you already mentioned people with MS, but how would it affect people with MS? Could most of us with MS take the vaccine, or what are the risks?
Yeah, so having MS alone is no contraindication to taking a vaccine. So having MS by itself does not mean that you shouldn't take the vaccine, because there's no concern that a vaccine will trigger off MS or trigger a relapse or make people worse. So I really encourage everyone with MS to look forward to taking this vaccine, unless they're told that they shouldn't do because of the drugs they're on. And that's the key determinant. So there are some drugs that are used to treat MS, which would make some vaccines either unsafe or ineffective.
So that's, I'm guessing, if people are on different DMDs then. So I guess it's the best way to just wait and see then what your neurologist or your MS team will tell you about whether you could have it or not.
I mean, clearly they're a good source of information. We can start to paint the picture now, though, to get the information out. So the first key thing we need to discover is whether or not the vaccine that we're offered is a live virus or not. So many people who are on DMTs at the moment will have been told that on this particular DMT, you cannot have a live vaccination.
Right.
And so good examples of that are polio, yellow fever, but also the MMR, measles, mumps and rubella vaccine. So those are live, and there are some drugs that it's just not safe to have a live vaccine on. Now, it's actually quite unlikely, I think, that we are going to get a live vaccine or live viral vector vaccine that is replicating. Most of the vaccines that we're looking at are inactivated or are with viral vectors that are not replicating, which is a complex way of saying they should be safe. So that's the first thing. Is this vaccine live or not? Now, if, as I hope it is, the vaccine will not be live or not be replicating, then it should be safe for everyone to take, regardless of what disease-modifying therapy they're on. However, it may not be effective. So just to run through that, obviously the whole point of a vaccine is that it triggers an immune response in you. And the drug, if you like, is not the vaccine, but it's your response. So you mount an immune response against the vaccine, and it's that immune response that's going to protect you against future attacks of COVID. And there are some MS drugs which particularly suppress the immune response to a level that means a vaccine may not be effective. So a really good example of this, drastic example, is the very effective drug alemtuzumab or Lemtrada really has a profound effect on the immune system for a few weeks. And we know that if you have a vaccine 4 weeks after Lemtrada, it will not make any difference to your immune system. It just won't be seen. But if you wait a year or two after Lemtrada, your immune system will recover enough to respond to a vaccine. So the key drug I think we should all be concerned about in this respect is ocrelizumab, right, a monoclonal antibody that's given every 6 months to deplete a particular part of the immune system called B cells. And it's the B cells that produce antibodies that are some, if not all, of the immunity against some vaccine. So we know that people who are on ocrelizumab have a reduced ability to respond to vaccines all the time they're on the drug. So not just the first few months after taking it, it's all the time they're taking it. So we don't yet know for sure because no one's done the tests, but it may well be that being on ocrelizumab means that the COVID vaccine is not as effective as it could be for that particular person.
You already talked a little bit about priorities and who would get it, because I'm guessing there might be limited supplies and sort of where people with MS would sit in this. But I suppose that would mean if people are working within a care environment or in a hospital environment, they might be offered the vaccine, not because they have MS, but because of their work then.
Yes, I think that'll be the first wave, healthcare and care workers. And then it'll be the high-risk populations. And that, so someone with MS is not high-risk by himself or herself. I think it would have to be, or I hope it would be, selective on the basis of high-risk, because someone with MS has high disability, which is a risk for COVID or severe COVID disease, or on particular immunosuppressant drugs.
Right. So perhaps similar people who got the letters for shielding.
Similar range of people, absolutely right.
So will this be free on the NHS then? Is that the plan?
Absolutely, absolutely. No question.
Because obviously with the influenza vaccine that we get offered, you can pay for it at pharmacies as well. I mean, do you think that it would be offered from?
I don't know for sure, but all that I read, which is I'm sure much the same as what you read, is that there's a big effort to push this through the NHS, and there's been no discussion of paying for the vaccines that I'm aware of.
That's good news. Makes it less confusing as well. Because I guess if there's different companies making it and they're all different versions of it, I guess it's if it just comes through the NHS, it will be simpler for us to make our
minds up. Yes, and I think it may well be the case, as you're implying, that actually different vaccines suit different sorts of people. So already we have different vaccines for children, some conditions, than we do for adults. And it may well be that older people need slightly different COVID vaccines than younger fit people. Yeah. Because of the way their immune system works.
I've heard some sort of murmurs about that children wouldn't be offered the vaccines. Yeah. But what about children with MS?
I mean, children per se and children with MS itself wouldn't be at high risk of severe COVID disease. Again, I think children with MS who are on disease-modifying therapies should be offered it if it's suitable. Yeah. I could just say in passing that,
of course,
obviously it's exciting news that a COVID vaccine, which I hope will be the first of many, has proven to be successful. I think people with MS will naturally want to focus on the potentially negative side of what I've said, is that's that group of people in whom a COVID vaccine may not be effective. But just to remind everyone that even if you, because of your circumstances, may not be able to have a vaccine because it's not safe or won't be effective. The fact that vaccine is available more widely through the population is good news for you as well, because that will control the pandemic. It will reduce the chance of you getting infected. So this really is good news for everyone.
What about people who are really worried about side effects of vaccines?
And we know that there's a significant population who are against vaccines, and we never get to the point where people are forced to have vaccines, because that would be quite wrong. Again, I think provided that proportion of the population who don't want a vaccine is relatively small, we still get the benefit of the wider proportion taking the vaccine and reducing the chance of transmission.
We've heard a little bit about trials stopping because of side effects and things like that, but I mean, they would never push through something that would be potentially dangerous, would they?
I mean, the Oxford trial has been paused twice, to my knowledge, but it has also restarted on each occasion. And I really wouldn't draw too many conclusions from that. That's quite a common practice, particularly in vaccine trials, that if you get any hint of concern that you pause, consider what you've seen, and then restart if it appears to be safe. So I think we can be confident that the regulatory authorities in Europe, the US, UK, will have safety very much on their mind.